That's pretty close. Yeah. Something. That's how I'd like to go. Hi everybody, welcome to Broadway Sessions! Yeah. Oh, very, very good sports. There was a lot of shenanigans happening up here earlier to get us warmed up, but you all applauded and clapped like you hadn't seen me yet, and I appreciate that. And that's why I put on this silly outfit. How many of you here at Broadway Sessions for the first time? So exciting, nearly everybody. All right, Broadway Sessions is not your grandpa's cabaret, my friends. This is a full-tackle theater experience. We had a write-up just the other week, and the gentleman who wrote the review of the Broadway Sessions described it as a musical theater frat party. And I cannot say that I disagree. So consider me your dead mother here tonight. The song that I just sang is from the 60s. I stole it many years ago. It says, everyone knows it's Bendy, when I first joined Actors Equity Association in the 90s. I had filled out a form that asked me for a first name, middle initial, last name. So I, being an obedient Mormon boy, wrote Bendy Cameron, which of course became my professional name, which sounds like a circus contortionist, which I am not any longer. So the name stuck around. I'm glad that you're here. Tonight is very, very exciting. I will tell you this before we even begin. By walking in the door tonight, each and every one of you has done something good and socially responsible. You've all made a donation to Broadway Cares Equity Fight Save. Near and dear to our hearts. So we appreciate that. We've been benefiting Broadway Cares for 13 years at this stage of the game, and it feels good to be able to give back to our community. Two might be right. This gentleman with a sensible man bun and the ne'er-do-well smile is our resident musical genius, Joshua Stephen Kartes! Oh, that was a sweet one. Josh, are you excited?
I am.
Yeah, this is going to be a darn good show. I'm going to tell you a little bit more about it, but first I'm going to let Josh sing a very short song.
Just going to do a ditty.
Just do a ditty.
Yeah.
And then, because he's really talented and you should know. Oh, it's jazzy.
I haven't sung this in ages. It has like 12 words, but I'm going to forget all of them.
Sounds weird.
Fly me to the moon, let me play among the stars. If my single spring is like dawn, you better admire. In other words, hold my hand. In other words, darling, kiss me. Fill my heart with song and let me sing forevermore. You are all I long for, all I worship and adore. In other words, please be true. In other words, I love you. Fly me See what spring is like on Jupiter and I is in another world. So my hair I wrote in other words. Daddy kissed me, this me, baby, well, so now let me sing the metaphor. You are my poor, my worship and adore. In other words, please be true.
Joshua Stephen Kartes, you're going to hear him a lot tonight. He's the best player in New York City. All right, get excited. Tonight, my friends, this is a very, very good thing. In recent months, we've talked a lot more, as we should have always spoken about, the swing studies and swing standbys and understudies in the Broadway community, because without them, we would not have had Broadway, well, frankly, ever. And certainly not for the last 3 months. And I'm glad that the conversation is out there, that people actually know what these superheroes do. We've gathered a bunch of these superheroes here tonight from shows like The Music Man and Hadestown and Dear Evan Hansen and The Phantom of the Opera and Come From Away and all that. And they're going to share with you a little bit of what it's like to be in those really remarkable positions as understudy swings and standbys. They are the most talented people on Broadway, bar none. So I'm very, very excited to have them here with us. Before we get to all Broadway stars, here at Broadway Sessions, not only do we feature Broadway's most talented performers here on the stage at the Laurie Beechman Theatre every 2 weeks, as we have been for 13 and a half years, we also have our Rising Star series, where we like to put the spotlight on performers who have yet to tread the boards on Great Big Broadway. And tonight I have two very special friends who have come from far and wide to sing for you and make their New York City debuts. So, we'll begin. This young lady has come all the way from St. Louis to be here. I teach musical theater workshops all over, and this young lady blew me away back in the fall. And I said, well, why don't you come to New York and come sing for the people? So, does that sound okay? How old are you?
I'm 17.
She's 17. She's 17 years old. She's enjoying a very stiff martini. Please welcome to stage our first rising star tonight, the very talented Caroline Carringer! Did you see that? Caroline knows what to do. Take it away. Is that mic good for you? Sometimes they get scared. They don't want to move the mic, but they should. Bye.
Someone give me a chance and just watch me break through. I deserve to be seen. This grief feels way overdue. I was born to perform more than anyone knows. I have passion for this. I want this and it shows. I thought I'd cried. I'd broke. I was bruised. The end of the day. This life is what I can choose. And so I am dance. All I need is a break. That is something more than I am. Someone give me this chance. I get more than the average no one. Let me give you this chance, you'll discover a star.
old that's going to sing a bow. She got this outfit, she came here, she's a star. Follow her on all of her social media or just run through the streets screaming her name. Mom, are you crying? That's exactly what you thought. If my child could do that, I don't have a child, but if I had a child and that child could end up doing that in that skirt, I'd be like, oh, weep. Our next rising star comes from Rochester, New York. I've known this guy since he was a tiny little baby, and now he's a grown Papa Bear man. Put your hands together for my buddy, Reed Burton. No, guys, really? He was like this. He was like, I want to sing. And I was like, let's do it. And now we're going to do it. Give it up. This is Reed Burton. So go warm up those notes and I'll get you later. All right, my friends, are you ready to meet some fabulous Broadway stars? Yeah, let's do it. I think that sounds great. Our first Broadway superstar very recently starred in Diana on Broadway. And not 2 days later, was swinging in to Come From Away on Broadway. 2 days after Diana had closed, they called her a runner, and it's absolutely insane to me. Please welcome the magnificent Holly Ann Butler. Yeah. It's gotta be alone somewhere. Okay. So,
hi,
Holland. You look wonderful tonight.
Oh, thanks so much. This old thing,
I just have it lying around. Who has the key to your heart?
There's a man sitting in the back. His name is L. Stephen Taylor. That's mine.
Oh, happy that he's here. Now everyone's looking around like, oh, God.
He's also fancy. He's also on Broadway.
He is. He's Mufasa in the Lion King.
Yes.
Yeah, true story. That's what we call a Broadway power couple.
Yeah.
And you guys do all sorts of fun, other crazy fun burlesque things, and you're very, very cool.
We like to dress up, and we're like fancy show people.
Yeah. What's the point in doing this if we can't be fancy show people?
That's right.
Children, learn it now. All right, so tell us how this all went down. When was the last time you were in Come From Away before Diana and then came back into the show so quickly?
It was almost 2 years to the day. And I had only been in Come From Away maybe 4 or 5 months total time before, because I was hired as a temporary standby to replace other standbys who are doing other things. So I had been with the show, and I'd only been on for, so the way that the show works, I don't know if you've seen it, but it's, there's only 12 people in the show. There's 6 men and 6 women, and so every standby covers 5 out of 6 of the women or men. And so there's only one that you don't cover, and then you have 2 primaries and 3 secondaries. So there's 2 people that you like absolutely have to know how to go on for, like tomorrow. I mean, you have to know how to go on for everything. But there's 2 that's like absolutely know this, and then the other 3 are like, you should also know this, but like you don't have to freak out quite as much about it. So.
But you will.
Yes, correct. Because you always get thrown on for the stuff that like they were like, you'll never go on for this, and then that's always what happens.
Yeah. You're doing a split track, and you're playing the guy as well. Yeah.
The great news about Come From Away is that you can't split track it. There are so many chairs. Why are there so many chairs? So it's like there's no way. We joke about it because our dance captain, Josh Breckenridge, we frequently joke that he'll be on for women someday. He'll be like Bula, you know.
The role he was born to play.
Yes. I was joking with somebody, I can't remember who I was talking to, that I was like, listen, before I was retaught some of the tracks I didn't remember, I was like, I will go out with notes and move chairs for you, but you have to say all the lines because I don't know.
And you know what? That's not totally off the table,
listen.
Right? Like, you show must go on, as they say.
Yep.
Yeah. So, okay, so you've got to call Diana Close.
Yeah, so 2 days later, I was at a gig downtown, and I was like getting dressed, and I got a text from the resident director, and he was like, hey, so, like, realistically, how many days do you think it would take you to be back in the show? And I said, for who? And he was like, anybody, just ballpark. And I was like, okay, for the 2 primaries that I used to know what I've been on for, I was like, yeah, like a day, I'll be fine. Reminders, I'll be good. There's a 3rd that I'm like, okay, I had to put in for that. I would probably be fine. And there's the other 2 where I was like, I did this with all the information. My brain dumped it so fast. And I was like, the other 2 is like, good luck. I don't even know the lines. I don't know how that goes. Who are they? What's their name? So, so he was like, fine, hold tight. An hour later, he was like, hey, can you be here tomorrow? So I went to the theater, and we got canceled that night. So they were like, hey, we're just going to run through the show, just with you and the dance captain and the other standby, Pearl Sun, who also hadn't been in the building in 2 months. And so we were like, we're just going to go over it. And it was so funny because I'm sitting there, and I'm like, I don't remember any of this. And you hear that, dun, 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 and you're like, 11:53 a.m. And all of a sudden, it's there. And it's like, you know, it's somewhere in the recesses of my brain. I keep saying it's like riding a very rusty bike. So yeah, like a couple days later after we came back, I was on for a week and a half, something like that. We had 8 standbys on out of a 12-person cast. They had to add space on the bottom of the in-out board, the one that's outside the theater that tells you who's on. They had to tape, they duct taped a section to the bottom of it so that we could add the slats for the extra people.
And you did the show!
We sure did.
That's incredible. All right, I'm going to give the stage to you and let you do your thing. Ladies and gentlemen, Holly Ann Butler.
Since we're talking about this already, I figured, why not?
My parents must have thought they had a crazy kid, 'cause I was one of those kids who always knew how.
watching them fly, something inside of me was starting. I was 8 when I told them that I'd be a pilot. But I was too young and too short, and there were no female captains. My dad said, be patient, he said, just see what happens. I took my first lesson, came down from the sky, told my father I'd fly for the rest of my life. And I got my first job, flying for a mortician in a tiny bonanza, just a corpse and me. $5 an hour for flying dead bodies. I had to climb over their faces just to get to my seat.
How many of you had dreams where you have to go into a show and you didn't rehearse? Clap right now. Have you had this dream? I still have that dream, and I haven't been in a show in a really long time. But every once in a while, I wake up in the night in a cold sweat, and I'm like, they want me to play Linda? What?
It's funny because, like, I... while I was joking about remembering everything that I was doing in the show, there was so many times, because the deal is, like, you rarely leave the stage, right? For Come From Away, it's like you go, so you don't get to check notes or do anything like that. It's like you go and then you're like, I hope I'm moving the right chairs. And so I would be fine when I was out there, And then I would get off stage and I would look at the guy playing Kevin T and I'd go, what happens now? And he was like, we're gonna make animal sounds. And I was like, great. It's just like, I was fine, because it was like, I go from here to here to here, and then you get off stage because you leave, you know, and then it's like no man's land, and I'm like, what is going on? The show isn't linear either, so it's like, okay, I'm like, what happens now? It's cardiologists? Great. Okay, sure. So it's just like a runaway train that doesn't stop, and you're just like, I hope this is right.
Just gonna wipe my bullets. That's do you feel so good when you get through it though?
Oh my god. Well, it's tricky because there's a point in the show, and all the standbys will tell you this, that after the song Somewhere, which is when everybody gets on the plane and they go home, you think, phew, I'm done. You're not done. You're not done. You still have to do like three more numbers, and they're like ones where you actually have to like do a bunch of poses and be in a bunch of formations and stuff. So you always feel like, I did it, and it's like, just kidding, girl, you got a lot more to go.
Oh my god. Okay, you should know this, that 2 days ago she sent me a message. She's like, I'm so sorry, I have to bow out of the show on Thursday because I just got called to go out and do the tour. I'll come from away. But luckily for us,
false positive!
It was a false positive! Which can't happen.
I did go out to the tour. Yeah. Like maybe a few weeks ago, I went to Minneapolis and did it all over again. But it was so funny because like they called and they said, you know, like, we're just gonna have you watch a show the first night. And then I was like about to head to the theater and the stage manager called me and said, so about that? And I said, for who? And it was the same track I've been on tour in New York. And I was like, oh, it's fine. But it was literally like,
there's totally different people next to you.
It was literally, nice to meet you. I'm Holly. Welcome to the Rock. It was just, it was so fun. I was cackling in the wings because there was really funny things that people were doing, and everybody is allowed to be an individual in that show. They let you kind of do whatever you do. So I was like cackling in the wings at one point because I was watching people do stuff I'd never seen before, and I was like, this is hilarious. Have you guys seen this?
They're like, okay, now you're on.
Okay, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, 11:53 a.m.
Yeah. Do you have another tune?
I sure do.
All right. One more time, Holly Ann Butler.
Hey. I dreamed a dream in days gone by, when hope was high and I was grateful. I dreamed that love would never die. I dreamed that Carl would be faithful. But I was young and so naive. Wasted. He led me home to Houston and seed. While he would leave no horror untasted. But my brothers came that night with their bull whips and their stun guns. First they tore his home apart. Yeah.
I just have one question, and it's probably the same question that you all have, and that's, who's Carl?
What the fuck was that?
No one now. We'll talk later. All right, our next performer is in the Book of Mormon on Broadway, where he stands by for the role of Elder Cunningham. Please welcome Noah Marlowe. Yeah, hi Noah! Welcome to the great big tiny stage in the basement on 42nd Street. Yeah, so you're 20 years old. Yeah, that's right, on Broadway, 20 years old. And tell us how this all happened that you're standing by for this role.
Sure, yeah, so I was a sophomore at the Boston Conservatory at Berkeley.
Great school.
And about 3 weeks out of my junior year, I got an email from my agent for the standby, and I went through about 4 or 5 rounds of auditions, and then like the fourth was like in person, and then the next day I got the offer, and then they're like, we need you in rehearsal tomorrow.
So you went to school and said, guys. So how much, on a scale of 1 to like Inferno, how much did the rest of your class hate you?
I don't know, I don't talk to them anymore. So.
And that's the showbiz. What's been the wackiest time that you've been thrown on for the show, or have you always had like a day to know that you're going on, or have you had to go in mid show?
I've only gone about 4 times since we opened.
Great. Okay.
I'm the newest cast member, so I joined in August, but nothing crazy for me. I mean,
Noah.
It really is. I know it. I went on once, and then I went on like 3 times in a row, and the first time I truly blacked out, truly did not remember the damn thing of that performance. So then once I did it 3 times in a row, I kind of got it.
And there's so much to being an artist who goes out there and carries so much of a show when you don't get to do it every single night. You just have to invest so much more energy into it.
Yeah.
It's really remarkable. And now we'll see how remarkable you are. Give it up for Noah Marlowe, everyone.
If I'm the only
It's such a good song. That's a good performance. Does anybody else have the overwhelming urge to just hug Noah Hyland?
No.
I just want to hug you and tell you it's going to be okay.
I appreciate
it. Get up for Noah Marlowe, everybody. Superstar Understudy Swing Standby comes to us from Hades Town. You know it, you love it. Please welcome Yale Yaya Wright. Is that the movement? I always want to do the movement with you. But I feel like there's also some, not at all. I got it all wrong. That's cool.
All wrong.
Thanks for being here. All
thanks
wrong.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, welcome to the Broadway Sessions. All right, tell us what you're doing in Hadestown. You cover muses and, go for it.
Yeah. I swing all of the workers and cover all of the fates.
That's like that when I said Jesus.
Yeah.
Yes, I'm a fence, of course. Terrible homosexual. Can't show my face on Tinder ever again. No. That's crazy. The fates, because that harmony is psychotic.
Yes, what's wild about both of those things is all the workers exist in one unit, all five sing different parts. All the fates exist in one unit, all sing three different parts.
So what's the rehearsal process for that? Like, to learn that.
This is my first Broadway show, so I don't know.
Congratulations!
Thank you. So I don't know how it usually goes, but a lot of my learning process was through osmosis. We were watching the remounting of the show and learning by watching.
And going home and having, what kind of nightmares did you have going home after rehearsals? Do you know what I mean? Like when you start rehearsals for any show, it's all you dream about. Why are you talking about dreams so much? I need a therapist.
Some pretty crazy dreams. I debuted in Fate 1.
Okay.
The soprano Fate that plays the violin, which I didn't play before we were doing this show. I do in the show.
That's pretty great.
It's just an impossible task, and you do it.
Yeah, you just figure it out.
Yeah,
we got some lessons and stuff. But I debuted Fate 1 without a put-in, and then they called me at 11 a.m. on
Tell
Saturday.
Tell someone here who may not know what a put-in is.
Okay, so a put-in rehearsal is where everyone comes. I can't see anyone.
They're all here. And they're all looking at you.
So put-in rehearsal is where someone new gets put into the show. Typically, as far as I know, the cast proper will be on the stage for a full run with tech elements, costume elements, everything as if the show would happen. And typically when someone's going into a track for the first time, they'll end up getting a put-in rehearsal so that they know what's going on. I didn't get that. I went on as Fate 1 on a Saturday night after having tracked backstage the matinee. Never did doubt in the lights with the turntable. It was dark with lots of fog. And then the next day I went on for Worker 3, which is typically a male worker track, tenor, vocal parts.
And do you sing the tenor line?
I do. They're like two notes that I have to change because I can't think. But yeah, it was a crazy, crazy debut again.
Yeah, see what I'm saying? Superheroes. Playing as symbols. That's extraordinary. We'd like to dedicate tonight's performance to Charlotte St. Martin. And if you got that joke, you get it? You got it. Get up for Yaya Wright, everyone. I was supposed to do that earlier and I forgot.
Can you hear me?
Oh, that was a bad move. Sorry.
Is that good? We're here. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Like shaking inside about the story, like I'm singing the piano. Then tomorrow. From all accounts.
No, I was just at a costume fitting at 11 a.m. And we had three previews. And for those of you who don't know what that means that things are changing every day. They're cutting 16 bars here. They're saying we're going to cut that 32 bars of dance. So swings generally are writing this all down in their cheat sheets and their notes and saying, oh, we're cutting that 16 measures. And oh my gosh, we're not going to do that part of the dance. And we're just going to straight to there. So we were, in normal times, you would be maybe in the wing, maybe watching your parts. But in COVID times, they were trying to keep the numbers backstage really, really tight. So all the swings and covers in our show were in the mezzanine. So we had no actual knowledge of the stage, of the wings, of any of the entrances. We were just sort of theoretical. And anyway,
you have to appreciate too how much backstage choreography there is on top of what's going on stage. You gotta go around a set piece, go under this thing.
I always said for BCFA, they should totally auction off a backstage seat so you just sit in the wing. Wouldn't that be amazing? If I had money, I would pay a lot of money for that. So that was the craziness. And I was at a costume fitting at 11, and the costume designer Santo says, "Kathy, call your stage manager." And I kind of had a feeling, that hideous feeling that goes down to the pit of your stomach, and I called him and I said, "Hey, Thomas." He said, "Kathy, you're on for Sutton."
Oh!
I could feel my fingers doing that thing. And I said, "Okay." And he said, "What do you need?"
"I need Jesus!"
I would like to go in order, please. Because sometimes when you're doing a put-in, sometimes they do the big numbers first so they can release people from the rehearsal. But since we had only had three previews and no rehearsals yet, I just knew that I didn't know the show well enough to go out of order.
Yeah.
And so that's what we did. And they squeezed me into two of Sutton's costumes. I got a little more boot. They squeezed me in Sutton's costume, so I didn't really have costumes yet either.
Had you taken it upon yourself, in the midst of everything changing and noting everything, to really try to cement Marion into your mind as well?
Well, I mean, I was cast. That was one of the things that they cast me as first, and the other covers came along the way. So I certainly had my eyes on it. But, you know, it's a different deal.
It's a different deal.
Actually do it. So, I
voice texted my husband because I knew that I couldn't do this. I said, I'm voice texting you because my hands are shaking so hard I know I can't hold the phone any longer, and I'm going to turn off all notifications, and I'm on for something, and say a prayer, bye. And then I got to the theater at noon, and they said, what do you need? And I said, I've never had some of the shoes on, because I did have my shoes.
Yeah.
So I just did a quick costume fitting, and then I just did the rehearsal like this. And we did everything once, and maybe did the tap twice, and I tried not to barf, and he said, forget about perfection, let's just have fun. And that was the, I know. What a jerk. That was the nicest thing you could possibly hear, because all I'm thinking of is a lot of people who paid a lot of money to see you and stuff, and now the chick named Kathy, who has no freaking clue. And the audience couldn't have been kinder. And the show went really remarkably well, and I did say thank you, Jesus.
Right before entering, what was right?
I said to my dress, where do I meet you at the end of this?